Welcome to Global Women Empowerment Sessions 2020. Woman is the 20. Woman is the full circle. Within her is the power to create, nurture, and transform. Today we have with us Dr. Purvi from Bangalore. She will be speaking about holistic wellness about women. Holistic women's wellness is very important, my dear friends. We should know how traditional healers have utilized natural lifestyle practices since ancient times. Let's understand the essential natural health practices for caring of our body, mind, heart, and soul through meditation, food, herbs, water, and many more through Purvi and through various feminine masters in this platform. So I'm Sri Lakshmi from UK, sharing, teaching, and spreading meditation in UK from the past years. Under the guidance of Patriji, we are doing this 111 Days Global Goddess Meditation Circle with 111 Feminine Masters across the globe. We have successfully entered into day 20 of our program. And before starting off our session, let's meditate for 2 minutes by connecting with all the higher masters, by all the higher beings. So I request everyone to please close your eyes for 2 minutes. Just focus on your normal and natural breath. Now, let's invite all the divine goddess energies. Let's invite angels, archangels, all the higher beings of love and light, Himalayan masters, and all the divine feminine masters in this universe. Connect with them. Experience the divine healing energies flowing from these masters. Let's send and radiate this love and compassionate energies flowing from all these divine beings to all the beings on this planet Earth. May all the living beings on this planet Earth live happy, healthy, and peaceful. Now gently place your hands on your eyes for 5 seconds and you can slowly open your eyes. So friends, I'm so happy to introduce today's speaker, Dr. Purvi from Bangalore. Dr. Purvi was born in Bangalore, Karnataka. She has done her MD-AM, Doctor of Medicine in Alternative Medicine and PhD in Alternative Medicine. Based on her expertise, she was selected for doctorate and PhD program in integrative medicine by Integrative Medicine University in USA. She was honored with the permanent resident status by the Government of Australia. Along with extraordinary performance in her studies, she has always had passion towards healing sciences. And she has learned many holistic therapies, my dear friends, from many renowned national and international therapists around the globe, which has proved to be magical, powerful tools in treating many issues using one's own mind power. Here are some of the subjects specialized by her. She specialized in subconscious mind programming, neuro-linguistic programming, emotional freedom technique, and life force energy, which deals with utilization of prana shakti for natural drugless recovery from diseases. Her campaign for drugless therapies is carried through popular workshops around the globe, where people are made aware of their innate abilities to get rid of several mysterious issues. She has been healing people through these drugless therapies and conducting courses around the globe to help people realize their own power and potential to make a beautiful journey as they desire. Hi, Purvi. We welcome you to this platform.
Such a beautiful introduction and for such a beautiful meditation that you channeled. That was amazing. Thank you.
Yes, Purvi, carry on. Yes.
So I think we'll quickly go through a small video and then we'll resume with the session.
Life is beautiful. Healthy life is the essence of meaningful existences. Integrating the emotional strength of mind, the functional capabilities of the body, and the power of soul. Dr. Purvi Jairath, the spiritual shaman, has been at the forefront of alternative medicines, holistic healing, and progress therapy, empowered with the knowledge of over 80 healing therapies. She has been pioneering and practicing trunkless therapy, conducting workshops around the globe. Samruddhi has changed the lives of so many people who are not getting cured even after taking lots of medicines. Here, people realize their innate abilities to get rid of several mysterious issues bothering.
And I'm really grateful to Purvi ma'am that she gave me a chance to recover my health again as it was earlier. And now I'm really happy that after coming here, I have gave this information to all my other friends also, and they have also come here and got healed themselves.
Dr. Purvi Jairath has studied several healing therapy techniques abroad, which she wants to benefit Indians.
Completely relax. How would you like to define the journey of your career of this lifetime? What terms defines your journey of working, of being a teacher?
ಒಂದೊಂದು ಉಸಿರು ತಗೊಂಡಾಗೋ ಒಂದೊಂದು ಉಸಿರು ಬಿಟ್ಟಾಗೋ ದೇಹ ಹಗುರ ಆಗ್ತಾ ಇದೆ, ಮನಸ್ಸು ವಿಶ್ರಾಂತಿ ಪಡಿತಾ ಇದೆ.
Dr. Purvi's well-spoken convictions about drugless therapy has been telecast on many popular television shows, where she has evidenced the successful recovery of hundreds of patients through her treatment without any medications or surgery, who had lost hope of recovery through any other conventional treatments.
So I would want to thank Samruddhi and Ms. Purvi Jairath, who's my holistic healer, and I also belovedly call her sensei because of all her education that she's had, and she's constantly guided me. So I really want to thank Samruddhi. I want to thank Mrs. Purvi Jairath for bringing or I would say for transforming my life. So thank you so much.
Dr. Purvi is the founder of Samruddhi, the Drugless Institute and Healing Center. Thousands of patients have tackled, realized, and overcome their diseases.
I thought this was the end of my life. I really didn't know something called holistic healing and something without medicines, because I could never take a medicine. I used to always vomit it out. So when I came to know something like this is there in this earth, I mean, it was really phenomenal. It was magical, and I love it, and I would tell everybody, advise everybody to go for this. What Purvi is doing, that is what is actually what we call holistic and universal energy for everybody. So this is the advice to our new generation, our children, and our children living in the world. This is what they should do and follow.
Dr. Purvi Jairath aims to cure all people, without any medicines and also wants to bring awareness about it.
Unfortunately, drugless therapy or alternative medicine has been considered as a mysterious science due to lack of awareness. But there's nothing absolutely mysterious about drugless therapy, because it involves looking at the deeper layer of the root cause behind the ailment or suffering of a person. For instance, a person could be suffering from different forms of psychological, physical, or emotional issues due to his own memory in the subconscious mind, due to some traumatic memory which is haunting in the inner layers of our consciousness. There also could be something that could have damaged the energy field of our own being. Since the energy field surrounding or being a part of the physical reality is not physically visible to the physical naked eyes, we tend to believe or disbelieve that there is absolutely nothing cosmic about a human being.
Dr. Purvi strengthens the faith in your vibrant subconscious mind, immense power of soul, and guides you to a healthy world. She always extends her helping hand whenever required.
Logical mind is barely like a circumference of life, whereas your intuitive mind, your inner self, is the real center. Tapping into the core of the reality, awakening your self-healing ability, realizing who truly you are, can create immense number of magic in your life. To believe that you are the magic creator, you can create the universe that you want, can help you lead a better life, and also awaken healing energies of people around you.
Thousands of testimonials of people sharing overwhelming inspirational stories of their recovery proves the efficiency of the services offered at Samruti. Yes, Samruti is the platform for your well-being. Dr. Purvi, the leading light of healthy life. The doctor is within your mind, and your own body has the medicines for you. Welcome to a wonderful world of healthy, happy, and blissful life.
Right, welcome everybody. This video is definitely less about the organization or my work and more about helping you develop a deeper insight that there is a possibility that you can help yourself at the physical level, emotional level, or even at the mental plane by awakening the innate capability, by tuning into the spiritual potential that we all experience in meditation. I'm sure all of you all who are watching this video are already meditators. You've had a glimpse of the magical essence that meditation can give us. And being a part of such a fantastic, huge, close-knitted family, like under the umbrella of Patricia's blessings, I'm sure most of you all have witnessed the magical experience of recovery at some level or the other. Now, being in this field professionally from past 8 years, there are certain key inputs that I would like to quickly share to understand how subtle and real things, which are most often termed as futile, useless, or probably too simple to believe that it can have a significant impact, or often ignored, which can have a major impact at the physical wellness or at the level of mental well-being of a person. So with all the experiences that we have had from the numerous clients that we get to meet as we are treating people, I would like to start this presentation by thanking all of them wholeheartedly, because though these people have come to us with some intention of getting better or with a list of big problems, they are the real wisdom keepers for us, or for me for that matter, because in the process of finding out their root cause or the holistic reasons behind them, there have always been new dimensions of understanding. So to start this session with gratitude is the best way to take this forward, is what I feel. So I often believe in having a good authentic route to whatever I speak. And being an Indian, it gives me immense pleasure to go back to our Vedas and Upanishads, as in our ancient scriptures, to understand how everything ultimately comes down to the space of heart, how by being in that grateful feeling of gratitude can actually awaken our senses to deeper realities. So this is a picture of one of the most ancient sages in India called Adi Shankaracharya, who says that if you are privileged to develop higher wisdom through all that transcendental experiences you've been having with Patri Sir and all the great masters, it is no doubt an effort of probably thousands and thousands of lifetime. And to be witnessing something so beautiful in your meditative experience is again a sadhana or an effort that's been running for many, many years, he says. So let's pat our back for coming all the way till here to understand how everything is connected and how doing anything actually impacts everything in health. Now, Lakshmi gave such a beautiful introduction about today's session. She said, this is about woman empowerment. This is about understanding the feminine energy at a deeper level and all the beautiful energy that she just invoked. It is of utmost importance to understand that though women seem to be very vulnerable and sensitive, the potential that can awaken, the very kundalini energy that can be awakened when we are a little aware, when we are a little conscious of what we do, has no match to anything whatsoever. So these are some of the things that as women, most of us would have gone through, be it being a pillar to our family, to doing all the multitasking, that if there is any suffering that pitches into our life, we often have one of these questions as to why am I suffering? Why did I go through this? Or will I be ever able to come out of this? Am I too weak to completely recover from this process? Or is it something that's going to stay with me forever? Will I be stuck to this identity of sickness? So let's just quickly go through what exactly this soul plan is all about and how at times sickness is manifest. I'm sure with this beautiful family and all the great masters that you guys have had privilege to share wisdom with would have already given a good insight about this. But just quickly to rewind on this, we all know we make our own life scripts. We come here having an agenda, a life purpose, and we go through multiple experiences. In this process, we go through certain diseases, sickness, ailments, or probably disasters to pick up on some core values and understandings to probably gather some strength and courage out of it. But without understanding that at a deeper level, we see sickness as something that's bound to be experienced for a lifetime or for a long time. And then we attach that with a lot of emotions and mental sickness and few other challenges, which probably starts making us so weak that we can't match up to the very life purpose for which we picked up on this struggle or this disease. So in this aspect, as I was experiencing this beautiful awakening through my patients and sufferers, there were some six key takeaways that I would like to quickly share with all of you today. So he's like the father, one of the major pioneers in yoga, BKS Iyengar. He says, the physical body is not only a temple for your soul, but it is a means by which we embark on the inward journey towards the core. So most of us have a preconceived notion that body definitely is a vehicle. Yes, maybe with a little deeper understanding is a divine temple. But what we fail to understand, that body is such a fantastic tool, a conduit for us to understand any sort of imbalance. So probably mind might take a little time to settle down to, you know, have those layers filtered. But body is something that instantly tells us there's a panic, there's an increase in heartbeat, there's some stress, then you feel like using restroom. So body is in its every cell aware and ready to communicate that big thing that you've always wanted to know, either at the spiritual level or at the karmic level or even at the mental level. So it is of utmost importance for somebody who's aspiring for a therapy which can go without any chemicals. So you need not go through a predefined therapeutic thing, but even at a very subtle level or at an individual level, you want to fight against some sickness, some trauma, some imbalances. You have to or got to know that it can only happen by spending a little time listening to your body. So what does listening to body mean? So as meditators, as you settle down with your senses, as you just relax and soak in that energy that's flowing in from the cosmic consciousness, you suddenly become aware that your body is reciprocating with your needs, with your demands, or with all that it is deficient of. So we got to just tune in and find out, just like how we give time to our best friends, to our partners, to our kids. Sometimes we know that if you're not connected, be it with your parents or with an old friend, then there's a gap, and then you just don't know what's happening in their life. And after probably a 10-15 years of gap, you meet them, you don't really connect that fast. You still connect back to the identity that you had probably a decade ago. So you know that you've got to constantly keep in touch and talk to them, and you know, be in alignment with their aspirations and goals or with their beliefs or feelings, to be in tune with that absolute love that you share for them. Similarly, body is no different. We tend to take it so much for granted that we don't sit down to listen to every single organ, especially with those organs which has never given us any trouble, because we think only when there's a trouble, I'm going to go back to that, if ever I'm going to go back to listen to the body. But my dear friends, it doesn't work like that. You got to go back to that organ, even if it's working good. Give love, give gratitude, communicate, and just tune in with your feelings of how you feel about that organ and how much of gratitude you're expressing. In between, I'm sorry for the interruption. Lakshmi, I just wanted to confirm if the flow is good and if I'm audible enough.
Yes, Purvi. Yes, everything is perfect.
Perfect. Thank you. So there is usually a tendency for me to talk too fast. So anyway, so sometimes we are, I would like to just quote a couple of examples to take this at a deeper level. We feel if you are having diet on time, if you have a, most of us have this preconceived notion that you have a diet chart, and usually it is copied from internet or some celebrity said, so I'll take that, and then I'll try my best to stretch my limits to follow that. But I'm sorry, most of the cases, this turns out to be a disastrous or a failure, because having your meals either 3 times or 4 times a day, or following a certain regime or a strict timetable, need not necessarily approve or give you a guarantee that you'll have a good physical health. I've seen a lot of clients who have always been extremely rigid about their schedule. They eat on time, they do everything on time, but then they have challenges. This is because you didn't really tune in, sit back and listen and communicate with your body as to what exactly it wants. Does it feel comfortable eating lunch at 2, or is it that it needs a little more time to assimilate what you had in the morning, or can you afford to skip it? Because we are not believing that eating food is appropriate only when you're hungry. We want to go by some preconceived stupid notion sometimes, that you feel if I skip this, if I don't have this, then maybe I will fall short of certain nutrients and I'll fall sick. It's probably more with your mind which is playing a game than your body demanding it. But sometimes you have closed that link, so your body can't share enough what it really needs. Now, whenever you have these issues of some body shame, for instance, this is just an example. For example, if somebody feels she's too thin to be called as beautiful, or maybe the dark circles are too big, or the curves are not really in alignment, and you're going through that inhibition and shyness for a long time in your life, then there is a high possibility that the same organ is going to come back as some sickness or disease, where you can come in terms and acceptance of the beautiful body structure that you've picked up from either from your family tree or your soul plan demanded it. And the other thing that we often see is the shyness about the private parts that women usually hold. I understand we live in a society where we'll have to fulfill the demands of most of the people, the way they look at us. But there is this sort of thing that happens right from birth. They say, you're a girl, so hide your private parts, hide your breast, hide that, hide this. Yes, it's pretty normal. As parents, they might instruct you. But unfortunately, the expressions that are exchanged when they're saying this is so adverse and negative that this girl starts believing that there's something absolutely awkward and negative and dirty about my own body. So this feeling usually gets amplified, and then that inhibition, that shyness can take any shape depending on what other adverse situations are attracted towards that lady. So sometimes this trauma, it could be birth trauma, because we know, especially in India, there are good number of people who tag you with, oh, it's a girl, oh my God, it's a girl again, oh, it's a girl, so what do I do, and things like that. So, and unfortunately, it's not just the trauma that occurs at birth. That girl is told even after a few years of birth, or probably forever that I wanted a baby boy, or maybe everybody had that expectation, things like that. So this non-acceptance can be coming from birth or during the time you were in your mother's womb. But since we don't remember that logically, we tend to take it for granted, and we don't know that subconsciously at the energy level, these things can actually be leading into a non-acceptance sort of a zone and can actually turn out to be a traumatic physical concern as well. So today I might not be able to touch upon all the aspects, but for sure we will see how far we can go till 4 o'clock, till we switch over to the guided meditation. So as I said, it's absolutely of immense necessity to choose what is right for you, what is tailor-made for you, depending on the insights that's coming to you when you tune into your body. And that can happen only if you are a good meditator. You need not be an expertise, but if you can give respect to the body, if you can say good things to your body, if you can spend a little time in front of mirror, not just having those artificial things, but embracing that natural thing that's come up without having too many cliches about it, like, you know, I'm not good enough, fit enough, beautiful enough, blah, 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 then your body is ready to give you that solution that you're waiting for, either in meditation or in your dream. So these people who have acknowledged their recovery without any medicines have actually started their journey by talking to your body, by giving love, by giving gratitude. So there's a quote that I wrote a few years back which said, your health is not just the physical condition of what exactly your body is projecting, but it's also about your perceptions, your reactions, your emotions, and your lifestyle. So this brings us to the next aspect, which is equally important. Now, what happens is when a person is aspirant of health, they believe that if they go for a medical checkup with the state-of-the-art technology and they get all their vitals tested and that seems to be in the normal zone, then they feel, yes, I'm all healthy. But I'm sure most of you all would have gone through an experience where your medical reports were normal, but then you still went through a lot of suffering, where you took what chemical was necessary for that condition, but something kept on continuing at different intervals of your life. And this have probably had an impact through your emotions. Now, emotions are something which are important because we feel that's connected with mental health. But what most of us don't know is this emotional well-being is directly proportional to physical health. So there's this beautiful quote, I'm sure by now you have read, that whether you're happy or sad, your body is constantly reciprocating with it, and there's a correlation. So when we are going through an emotional trauma, there are umpteen number of researchers which tell us that when you are probably falling in love genuinely with somebody, you know, the nervous system are getting better. These are all different researches that you can see on the slides. When you are depressed or low mood, you know, the levels of serotonin going down, the dopamine and all the happy hormones being reduced drastically has an immediate impact on the body. So we think crying, screaming or nagging or elaborating on things or contemplating on things which are not really important or just probably the mind thing, but I'm sorry, directly impacts the body as well. So for women, it's something of utmost importance because we women are the popular ones who probably are famous for blowing things out of proportion. Of course, men do that as well, but then not as much as women, as far as I have seen. So a good laughter, a good humorous, celebrative ambience that is created within our family or with our spiritual ambience actually can lead into cellular repair. I wish I could read through it, but since we are running short of time, you can read through the slides where their repair capacity rose by a magnificent 87%. In fact, you'll not believe me, there were researchers which proved that the tears that flow in meditative state and bliss are bearing capabilities of recovery, and the tears that flow when we fight and in aggression are actually bearing chemicals which damage our internal system. So there was this beautiful research that was done by Dr. William Frey. And of course, most of us know that when there is a psychological stress because of the internal emotional turmoil that can come from any incidents. Trust me, these incidences are not something extremely tragic, because when I'm saying this, you could think, okay, maybe this is depression, maybe this is some breakup or something that prolonged. No. Trust me, I've seen thousands of people where they come to me and they're not sure whether that has impacted them. But when we dig deeper into their emotional capabilities, they have told something as silly as, you know what, my mom was partial towards giving a bigger share of chocolate to my brother. And they still hold on to it. This, imagine this happened like 20, 30 years back when they were barely 4 or 5 years. And that thing was still lingering in their subconscious. And that emotional lack would have created a lot of ups and downs in their physical level as well. So this, everything about your immune molecules, to your cholesterol levels, to your inflammation, which is the biggest thing and contributor for chronic disease, is all connected with your emotional response. There are umpteen number of other researches, so we'll skip on that just to ensure that we can cover on the other aspect. So what do we do about it? All the beautiful thing that meditation teaches us, we feel spiritual is for people who are retired or people who talk only philosophical things. But my dear friends, please understand, this has been scientifically proven that forgiveness can actually amplify the happy hormones. It makes your energy feel more vibrant. Spiritually also it makes sense. So every time somebody recalls a bitter past, it is going to do equal amount of damage as it did when you experienced it. So letting go of it, releasing your past, empowering yourself with detoxification of emotions, maintaining a beautiful journal of how far am I strengthening myself emotionally, have all proven to have a significant impact on amplifying your physical wellness. So that brings us to the next most beautiful and something that's given fantabulous results in recovery of any mysterious problem is the aspect of mind. So there's this beautiful quote that you're reading. I believe that when body is strong, the mind is thinking strong thoughts. So this is the connection that we all hold with the mind. So we feel positive thinking keeps our mind cool and going. Maybe a little bit of goal achievement is good. But trust me, I quoted something in the beginning. I would like to re-quote it. Anything that you do is connected with everything that you are. So the thoughts that you create are not just something that makes you feel popular among a few pessimistic people, but it actually has been scientifically proven that these feelings, these emotions, these depression, anger, or the pressure that comes from mind actually determines the way your organs work. So there's been a lot of research in this regard. This is one of my key works as well, that when there are bombardment, there's a bombardment of negative thoughts, when you are in the mindset of nagging or complaining, when you are probably self-degrading yourself, that's just an example. We all know how a negative mind works. There's an instant connection with your immune system, and we know what happens with a weak immunity. You are susceptible to any virus that you're all scared of, or you are more open towards being in anxiety and depression, which can lead to suicide. But the other side of it, these chemical reactions that happen in the brain eventually passes on to vital organs, be it heart or your blood or your intestine. So there is this close-knitted connection between, I'd like to just quote an example. We all know how uneasy our tummy feels when we are stressed, how our digestion is usually weak, or for that matter, how you don't want to eat in anger. You're like, no, I'm angry on you. Don't give me food. I'm not eating food for 2 days. So it's not just your decision. It's your body telling you that since you are mentally stressed up, do not dump things into your body, because I'm going to take a lot of time to digest this, and probably that will lead into further complications. So this is how they are all deeply connected. Trust me, any chronic cancerous disease to something as small as a small infection, all has an impact that is being influenced by your thoughts. So these are all deeper level of explanation. I would like to skip them. So it's research proven that stress or some negative thoughts can have an impact on your skin, on your gut, on your reproductive system, your period cycle, your immunity, your joints, your muscles, and everything for that matter. So we know the division between the parasympathetic and the sympathetic nervous system, and how while in stress, you are more prone towards, susceptible towards being in the sympathetic zone, and how immediately your body vital organs starts shutting down their work. And if prolonged to be in the stress, you are at a high risk of ill health, which would probably be very difficult to revive it back to normal at a later stage. So we all very well know about, as meditators, I'm sure you know, about the bifurcation of the conscious and the subconscious mind and how it really works. And this has been discussed for thousands of years in India in the ancient scriptures about samskara chitta, which means the impression mind, where they gave a lot of importance to what made major impressions on your mind eventually went deeper down into the record holder of your shells and then deeper into creating sickness in your organ level. So this is something that yoga and Ayurveda has always propagated, but unfortunately that's been parked aside and we just, you know, want to go on making investigations on your gut if there's some digestive issue without even having the second thought. Wait, is it because of the stress that my job is giving me? Is it because I'm not getting enough love from my loved ones? Is it because I don't express enough gratitude? Nobody wants to think in these terms. And fortunately or unfortunately, there's no technology which can tell you all this. It's the super technology of your mind that is meditation, and only meditation that can help us open these senses for us and understand where the disease is actually being manifested. So how do we do this? How do we empower this? You have to stop making self-degrading statements. You have to empower your inner mind. Just like you feed your body with food, you got to empower yourself with positive affirmations. You got to, I was just looking at Lakshmi. She is sitting in front of such a beautiful poster where you have positive words. It was so nice to see that as soon as I started the session. So these keywords and the things that surround us and the thing that we sink into our system actually are the food that we are giving at the software level to the organs, and they make an impact. It's not just I'm a meditator, I'm spiritual, so I feel nice. Of course it is that, but it's really empowering your physical body as well. So those people who have been running this race of I got myself investigated because it was free, it was given by my company, are really not understanding that there is another free tool that is there. You don't have to wait to jump into a new job for it, or probably to get a visa somewhere. You can just sit down, connect with your mind, and you'll know where the mind is pushing its insecurities and imbalances through the body, which eventually can project itself as a disease or has already started. So you got to learn tools. We guys are so lucky. Lakshmi was telling the 111 meditators who are going to come together to share insights. So pick up on those tools and make a beautiful journal. Have your own diary, probably a small stuff like this where you can just jot down, or maybe a small handy one which can go in your purse, which I always carry when I'm going out. And then you're just being a little aware about anything significant that happened, and you're quickly recalling that tool which can instantly ground you. You know, when there's a short circuit, you have a fuse. In India, we use that. I'm not sure how it is in other places, where instantly it turns off the power so that you can go and look into the issue. But unfortunately, we are not having that fuse, and that is awareness. You got to just be there for yourself, and that can save us from a lot of tedious medical procedures. Trust me, I'm not against any conventional methods, but I'm just trying to make a point that if you can pause down and have a multidimensional approach towards well-being, you can actually empower yourself at a deeper level without torturing your body eventually with other things which can complicate you so much and entangle you so much that you'll not know the way out. So developing positive language with your own self. So we all use languages. I'm using language to talk to you all now. I'm using English. We use another language at home sometimes, but we don't understand that there's a language that we talk to our own selves. And that is no language that's scripted anywhere or taught to us by our parents or community. It is a language that you programmed in these 2 years of your lifetime, which you got to sit down in the night just before going to bed or as soon as you wake up and start giving yourself those affirmations, those thoughts, those programming, which you believe is the software that has to be projected in certain energy and seal or the organic health that you want to give to yourself. So most of the people have this complaint, you know, how do I do it? I don't know. How do I communicate? I don't know. So I ask them, do you have a pet at home? Most of them say yes. So if you can talk to a pet which doesn't know your mother tongue and you don't know dog's language, I can bet you on that. But within a period of 10-15 days, you both are communicating. It has become so smart that it can pick up on your instructions. When you can do that, when you feel the less, so-called lesser, but it is actually most of the times more evolved than us. So animal can pick up on your instruction and probably make you obstruct. Then why are you thinking your own body will not listen to you? What sort of excuse is that? I mean, is it that a part of your mind is not willing for recovery or what? Or are you so used to a monotonous way of looking at your body with all the interventions from externally that you don't want to believe that there is a simple remedy? What is it? Recently in my meditation session, I got insight, a thought in my mind which is so beautiful, I thought I'll just share it now. I was told that if you don't want to believe that a simple tip in your meditation can heal a huge disease, then think a huge door can be opened with a small key. But if you don't want to believe that this small key can open the door, then you have only other option of breaking the door. So we know what disadvantages of breaking door is. Door can't be put back again in the same condition. Probably it'll even crack the walls. Similarly, if you don't want to believe that a small single positive thought can be a great cure for your body, that's like the key, then you got to break it open. Make major surgeries and interventions, which probably is not going to put you back into the same zone of vitality. All right. So we know about this famous quote of Nikola Tesla, one of my favorites. If you want to find secrets of the universe, think in terms of energy and frequency and vibration. So that brings us to the next significant aspect, which is spirituality. I don't want to elaborate too much on this, because in these few days of experiences you guys have had, I'm sure you understand what exactly I'm trying to say. But friends, try to understand that meditation not just gives you an ecstasy or a blissful feeling or a contentment or this ego statement that I am spiritual. It is so much beyond it, because you are becoming one with the universal consciousness. You connect with yourself as much as you can connect with Lakshmi, and you don't see a difference. You connect with another meditator as much as you connect with your self-love. And these self-inquiry and these oneness consciousness can actually create such fantabulous changes in your genetics, in your DNA. It's proved. In fact, there's a very famous therapist in India, in Karnataka especially, called B.M. Hegde. He's written a book. Patri sir had invited sir also on one of the gatherings. He has written a beautiful book called What Medical Doctors Don't Get to Read or Study, where he says that these satsanga, these spiritual gatherings, actually make a change at the cellular level so deep that it can never be found in any other events or interventions. So the acceptability of spiritual way of life is not just making us good person, which is definitely hard to gain through any other means, but it is also taking real good care of yourself, because the energy body is becoming better. The vitals, that is the subtle body, which cannot be identified through any other conventional methods, are getting stronger. And through that, you gather more and more cosmic energy, which is a real healer for your organs. Because when you were in your mother's womb, you didn't come as a package. You started evolving, you started doing a lot of processing, and the universe was backing you up. And with all the cosmic energy, there was this eye at the right place, the heart placed at the right place, and all the genetics and everything, all that just happened to be right. Because you were evolved, aware, there, right from the beginning. But then once you had a form, and then the brain, where the problem started, and the mind, where people started telling, it's just about the body, just about the body, you forgot where you started from. You forgot where you actually started from zero and build it to one, that is a physical identity, was actually the spiritual energy. And you don't want to believe it. You need proof. You need validation. You are like, okay, let me see. I'll give it a try. Why is it? What is holding you back? Is it that you don't want to reveal the true identity to yourself? Or is it that you're so lost by copying others' identity, by making photocopies of what others believe, that you don't want it to, you didn't want to create an art of your own self like you created your body? So it's no different than the journey that you had in your mother's womb. So spirituality is not resigning from what you do. It is assigning everything that you do to spiritual self. This thought came to me in meditation a few months back. And it's so meaningful, because it's not that you let go of everything and become spiritual. It is see everything with this sight. And that actually opens a bigger dimension of health. So that brings us to the last minute of the session, which is the social and the behavioral concepts. So we feel social concept is throwing few parties. I'm sorry, it's not just that. All that we are doing now, the gathering that we have, the virtual gathering that we have, is the social connect. The connect that can amplify your well-being, your families, and at the community at large. The behavioral thing of, you know, making small changes in our speech and actions and effort and mind is not just about being a dignified celebrity like a person, but it actually impacts your organs, because we know about the very famous Mozuro Emoto's research, where a word that was uttered was immediately having an impact on a droplet of water. This is a very famous research. I'm sure all of you all know about it. So if that's reality, then how come it's different for your body? It is the same. The behavioral attributes that you give to yourself and the way you behave with the little ones, with plants, with animals, the way you treat your books, the way you treat your bedspread as soon as you wake up in the morning, is all being a part of your physical reality. So if somebody has had an impact on the body without taking chemicals, it's because these vital six aspects were taken care of. So this was the quick essence of what basically drugless or holistic therapy is all about. This is not predefined or pre-moduled thing where you have to follow something rigidly and you reach there. This is something that can occur at every level of consciousness if you're willing to in your everyday experience, and then see a new dimension towards the sickness, which is a beautiful blessing in fact for you to work on it. So there's this beautiful poem that I wrote in my childhood, having no clue what was flowing through. Anyway, when time permits, you guys can go through this. Now let's just try and have a beautiful guided meditation quickly for 10 minutes, where I will try and connect our essence back to that beautiful, significant, magnificent, vibrant, divine essence that we all carried. And as we grew up, nobody spoke about it, nobody really put light, and we are so fortunate that enlightened masters like Patri sir and all the beautiful other angelic energies have had their lifetime dedicated to this, to put their torchlight on it, to put that light, to shed that light on us, where we could go back and see, oh my God, I also bear that light. It's just that I have to do a lot more sadhana, be a lot more awareful and accepting, like enlightened masters, to be in that path. So let's just at least go back and, you know, see that light, so that we can work towards embracing more of it. So my dear friends, gently close your eyes, please. Deeply inhale and exhale, and focus on your natural inhalations and exhalations. Every time you inhale and every time you exhale, think, feel, or visualize that you're diving into a deep state of relaxation. Deeply inhale and deeply exhale. Now slowly imagine a beautiful garden, where there's green grass spread all over like green carpet. Fragrance of flowers, chirping of birds, and all the beautiful exotic panorama around is helping you dive into a deep state of relaxation. Let's now go back in time. Let's time travel. Look at your own self, your body, physical age, the biological age that you are identifying yourself with. Let's walk past the statistics and go back in time to our childhood, when the programming of this is you, this is your identity, this is how you look, you're dark skinned, you're fair skinned, you're short, you're tall, you're negative, you're positive, and so many other attributes were prefixed to our names and our identity. Let's walk back in time. Let's go back to that time when we were a toddler, when you were a toddler, a little one, where your mind, your conscious mind was about to evolve and pick up on things through those innumerable questions you made to your parents. The question was never to get a satisfied answer, but to evolve your mind further. But what if we go beyond that? Where you're just crawling, and your definition of happiness is so different from what your parents believed or the society dictated to you. Let's walk past that. And now, think of the time when you were safe in the arms of your parents or your mother, where your entire universe was the identity of this beautiful lady who was cuddling you with so much love. Let's dive in deeper, further back, into the time when the universe gave all its divine best blessings to manifest you into the physical reality. Let's go back deeper and further to that time zone when you're yet to choose your parents. You are at the soul plane, receiving all the guidance and mentoring by your spiritual angelic beings and mentors. You're here planning the best life script to project the best version of yourself this time as you explore and experience this opportunity to get a role on Mother Earth. As you're pouring down your wills and wishes, and as you're calibrating them with all that karmic release and understanding that you want to gather through this lifetime that you're going to explore, there is an essence, energy, like a golden ball of light that's covering you, that's engulfing you. This spirit, this energy, this blessing, this awakening, this understanding and alertness that I'm going to dive in now into Mother Earth through the chosen divine parents to explore my purpose of life and manifest the highest version of myself is now sparkling bright like golden light to ensure that you don't forget that. To ensure that you're not lost with all the other false identities that you might pick up. To ensure that you don't forget to tune back into your own self. And the very reason that you were there. As you jot down all those beautiful, significant experiences that you want to bear, the essence in you, before you would even think of a physical identity that you would gain in your mother's womb, is now sparkling like bright golden light. Glittering with its effulgence, so radiant and beautiful. Look, this represents your aspirations, your love for life, your zeal, your potential, your purpose, and your innocence. Your conviction and clarity, your blessings that you're observing in this soul consciousness, and the projection of all that great learnings that you had in multiple previous lifetimes. Thank you. This is your I will do it. I can do it. I can make it. Yes, I am the master. I am the creator. Wisdom that you are bearing with you, that is yours. That is your identity, in fact. Now, as you slowly and gently move towards the beautiful journey of accessing the divine sacred space of your mother womb, mother's womb, you carry this essence, this golden spark, this light with you. Yes, there have been acceptance or negligence, ignorance or depression about your presence in womb, depending on the parents you chose or the lessons you wanted to learn. Maybe some parents didn't want you. Maybe in some situations they wanted a particular gender. But remember, that was their thought. You belong to this essence, this light that you carried, this purpose that you hold. You belong to this beautiful sacred essence that is the Parabrahman, that is universal consciousness. Slowly and gently move forward in time now. You're almost about to give yourself a gift of life. You're almost about to take birth. Yes, there's pain. Your mom is screaming and there's apprehension. There could be trauma as you're taking birth. But look, look at the essence, look at the energy, the grace that which you're carrying along with you, and the first cry that you'll make, of recalling where you really belong to, of the energy that you have constantly used to make that physical identity present. Here you are with your birth. Here you are. With all that grace that universe always wanted to see through you, the will that God wanted to project through you, you bear that light in you, irrespective of all the terms that your parents already started dictating, that you'll be a lawyer, a doctor, XYZ. You'll inherit my business. But then your essence is intact. Yes, they have their own logical intervention trying to kill your free will. But look, your essence is still vibrant and strong. It could be in alignment with your thoughts, but maybe not. Is it an affected or affected? It is not affected, clearly not. When they were apprehensive of you, doubtful of your capabilities, when they made wrong choices for you, the darkness didn't affect the light that you bear, because your light only gave more light to the darkness that they possessed. And if they made choices that was appropriate for you, it only made you feel more at ease. Move forward. You are in your childhood days. People are already tagging you with caste, with creed. People are already attaching you with the identity of looking similar to father or mother. People already know your attributes more than your own self. Dull, active, vibrant, stupid, moron, intelligent. Are you just that? Oh, it's just an interpretation of an outsider. But what truly you are is that essence that you always had in you. You are that identity of unlimitedness. Move forward. Move forward. Move forward and come to your adolescence. There are ups and downs through your body. Your hormones going crazy and cranky. You don't know what choices to make. You project them as aggression and aversion. You present them as taboo, as awkwardness about certain growth of certain organs in your body. But then, are you that? You are that essence, that purity, that acceptance and beauty, which can never fade, no matter how dull or beautiful or vibrant your skin looks like. No matter how many pimples you get on your skin or how much hair is shedding. Look how beautiful and joyous this light is. Irrespective of all the fights you've witnessed by then in your family or society. And look how beautiful and magnificent this light is. As you make choices for your own self. As to what specialization you want to gain and explore. You are that light that you're witnessing now. Move forward. You've made choices, some on your own, some forced and forged on your behalf. But the essence is unaffected. It is finding brighter and better ways to explore and express itself. And that moment of meditation that touched your life is where the spark exploded and gave you a glimpse of how huge and magnificent you truly are. With this bearing in your heart, with a joy in your senses. You are that light that spreads into your physical awareness, your emotional stability, your mental ups and downs, or your spiritual inquisitiveness. Let that spread amplify further and move into choices you make, the food that you eat, the workout that you do is appropriate for you, the books that you read, the people you connect with, and the joy that you define for yourself, which is true in nature. Let's enjoy the celebration by surrendering all that we are to the universal consciousness, with a beautiful, innocent inner child singing its heart out of how pure we are, irrespective of all that has happened, and how easy it is, and how simple it is to tap into it. As you enjoy the song, visualize the golden lights sparkling bright and embracing it in deeper, deeper and deeper acceptance throughout this lifetime.
If we could, we would fill our hands with all the wonderful things you give us. Then we'd lift them up and give them back to you.
I give it to you, Lord.
and do it thankfully. Thankfully, every song I sing, every praise I bring, everything I do is a gift to you.
Right. Thank you, all you beautiful souls. Thank you for your patience. Thank you for being a part of this beautiful spiritual family. Thank you for all that you guys do in your individual lives. And thank you so much for listening to that calling that came from deep from your heart to spiritually awaken that energy, that truth that your inner self was longing for. Thank you, Lakshmi, and thank you, team. Great effort. It was great to be spending this 1 hour with you. I'm sorry I took, I think, 7 minutes additional. I'm sorry for that. But yes.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much, Purvi. Really, what a wonderful session it was. Literally, I enjoyed a lot. And the meditation was so awesome. And yes, we are not this. We are not our thoughts, our mind, our emotion. We are the pure essence. When you're saying that words, literally I could experience that oneness, that I'm the soul, I'm not this. Because when everyone will get aware of this, I'm this essence, then all the problems in this world will.
Absolutely. Yes. We'll all work towards it as much as we can.
Yes, Purvi. Thank you so much. In this short span of time, you mentioned, like, you covered almost everything.
Thank you.
Yes,
I hope I was not too fast. I just wanted to ensure that.
But your flow was very good. Your flow, because
good.
Yes, thank you. Thank you so much, friends, for joining today's session. And tomorrow, let's connect with one more master.